would turn in your Bibles, please, to Psalm number 56. Psalm 56 has a title which places it in history. We know when in David's life it occurred and when he wrote it. It says, "To the choir master, according to the dove on far-off terebinths, a mitkam of David, when the Philistines seized him in Gath." The story of this event occurred in 1 Samuel chapters 21 and 22. We have already looked at David running from Saul and running to the priests at Nob. And at Nob, the head priest gave him bread and gave him Goliath's sword. And then sometime later, a person by the name of Doug told Saul about this, and Saul came and Doug slaughtered 85 priests and their families to get back at this helping of David. Now, between the getting of the bread and the sword and Doug and Saul coming and killing the priests, David goes to a town called Gath. Gath is a Philistine town. If you read the story of Goliath, Goliath is referred to as Goliath of Gath. Gath is Goliath's hometown. Goliath was the champion of the Philistines. He was the person that they were putting all of their eggs in his basket, as it were, that he would lead the charge, he would lead the army. He was this big, monstrous, nasty guy. And so David goes to his hometown, and his theory, even though the Bible doesn't say this, he must have been thinking something along the lines of, "The enemy of my enemy is my friend." Saul hated David, Saul hated the Philistines, so David saw the Philistines as an ally against Saul. The difficulty is the Philistines didn't see David as an ally against Saul. The Philistines hated everybody. The Philistines were going for world domination. And so for one little pipsqueak person who was going to be king but was not king yet shows up, that didn't look good to them. They didn't say, "Oh, what a great friend we now have in David." And so they begin to turn against him as he is in their town. One reason is that David had a reputation, and David's reputation came before him. Achish is the king of the Philistines, and so David is wandering around Gath meeting people and glad-handing people, and the servants of Achish, or the Philistines, go to the king and say, "Is not this David the king of the land? Did they not sing to one another of him in dances? Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s." And so this is what the Israelites sang after David killed Goliath, that he was this great warrior, that Saul had killed thousands, David had killed 10,000s. This song, this refrain, had reached the ears of the Philistines, and the Philistines know that when the song says David has killed his 10,000s, those 10,000s are 10,000 Philistines. And so they don't look at David and say, "Oh, what a great friend." They look at David and say, "Oh, you're the enemy of the Philistines. You've come here to kill us." And so the story continues beyond this psalm, where David realizes his difficulty. And he actually feigns mental illness. He acts like a crazy guy. And because he's acting so crazy and acting like an animal, in essence, they think that he has just gone off the deep end, that he's now just, you know, whatever, crazy. And they kick him out of town instead of trying him for the crimes of killing all the people. Another difficulty of him going to Gath is that he is holding Goliath's sword. Back then, they did not have mass production. You didn't go to the sword store and buy a sword and everybody's were the same. Every warrior made their own sword or commissioned their own sword to be made. And so Goliath's sword was large. and it was one of a kind, and it would probably, because it belonged to their champion, be recognized. And so the fact that there was this refrain in their head about David being such a great warrior, and because he is holding the trophy of his battle, Goliath's sword, they turn against him and they want to get him out of Gath or kill him. In the title here, it says, according to the dove on far-off terebinths. This is a tune, if you will, that people think they have figured out, that when the exile happened and the Babylonians came in and moved the Jewish people to Babylon, that this is one of the tunes, a dove afar off, a mourning dove, if you will, is a tune that was used for singing the sad songs in Babylon. And so they believe that it was that this psalm was used to that tune to, even at the late date of being in Babylon or the first captivity to Assyria, that they would sing and understand this psalm to be even about that, that people are against them, but no matter who is against them, what can man do to me? If God is on my side, what can anybody on this earth do to me, is the mindset that comes out of this psalm, and it was used throughout Jewish difficulties and Jewish tribulation. And so he starts out by saying, God, be merciful. In the ESV, it says, be gracious unto me. The word gracious can be mean grace, can be merciful. And he starts off many of his psalms this way, of God, have mercy on me. And I have heard people today say, well, this is kind of an Old Testament way of thinking, an Old Testament way of looking at it, because we don't have to ask for mercy today because we have mercy through Jesus Christ, because Christ has come and he has died for us as an act of grace, and we receive that grace, we receive that mercy, and we're saved, and therefore we're in. But the early church understood that even if you're saved as saved can be, even if you are destined for heaven's shiny shores, everything you get day by day to live is a mercy from God, that even though I am absolutely saved, I know that I am a child of God, I know that all my sins are forgiven, in the large picture, the only thing I deserve from God is the flaming pits of hell. My whole life on this earth, the only thing I deserve, if we are working off of what I have earned in this life, it is the flaming pits of hell. So even though I'm saved, I still see my relationship with God as one of mercy and one of grace. And I can ask for mercy. I can plead for mercy in my prayers. I can say, hey, God, have mercy. I don't deserve this. I know that I have sinned and I am confessing my sins. Have mercy on me. And that is an understanding of the relationship that we have with God as one of mercy and one of grace. He then talks about his fear, and his fear, you can imagine, if you will, David is you know, tromping around Gath, saying, thinking, these guys are going to be my buddies because they don't like Saul, I don't like Saul. And as he begins to see people turn on him, as he begins to see the king make statements against him, he begins to have fear. He begins to realize that where he is at was not a good place to be, and fear for his life is coming upon him. Now, if we look at the Bible and look at this story and we say, well, he deserves what he gets. I mean, he was stupid to go into enemy territory. He should get his just desserts, as it were. He gets whatever, you know, the Philistines want to do to him. But the Bible, and you can read it cover to cover, you can read every story, every letter, every narrative, never makes the distinction between suffering that is because of something we did and suffering that is put onto us externally. The only thing that comes close is that they debate it in the book of Job, but they never come to a conclusion. The friends of Job say, "You're suffering because you sinned." Job is saying, "I'm suffering and I didn't sin." And that's the debate. And God says, "Shut up, don't worry about it. He's in charge of everything." The idea that we can look at people today and say, "Well, you got involved in meth, and therefore you're losing all these things in your life. Your focus is off, and therefore you get the consequences. And therefore I'm going to leave you to figure that out for yourself," is not a biblical position. Everybody that is suffering, truly suffering, needs our compassion and needs our care, needs us to come alongside and calm their suffering and help them where we can. And a lot, and we might say everybody, has come to the situation where a tragedy, a catastrophe, a level of suffering has occurred because of something stupid I did, because I wasn't thinking, or I thought this investment looked great and I lost everything, or whatever I did because I didn't stop and act out of wisdom and pray about it. And there is no evidence in 1 Samuel that David prayed any length of time saying, "Should I go to the Philistine homeland?" He just did it because he felt he had no choice, because he was, some have said, desperate, because he felt trapped in a situation. He went and did something that we might say, "Well, that's stupid. He should have gone to the caves, or he should have gone to the desert. He should have been alone." And he does that after Gath. After Gath, he goes to the caves above Jerusalem, and he begins to send messages to those who are loyal. And over a period of months, being alone, he's able to gather around him 400 of his mighty men and have a little army that can now protect him, that can now move him into the kingship. But instead of doing that first, which seems the wise, intelligent things to do, he takes a little detour through the Philistine homeland. And even though that was a dumb thing to do, even though he was working out of fear, we might say, he can still say, "Have mercy," and God will still have mercy on him. From God's point of view, I believe, because of how Scripture states it, God does not look at your suffering and say, "Oh, you deserve that, but you don't deserve that. Oh, you deserve that, but you don't deserve that." All human suffering is because of sin. I wouldn't make dumb choices and go to the Philistine homeland if there wasn't sin within me. I wouldn't make dumb choices and try this drug or this investment or hang out with these friends or whatever people do to bring suffering into their life. I wouldn't do any of these choices if there wasn't sin. And so suffering is suffering is suffering. Now, from our standpoint, there are consequences. Somebody commits a crime, they must pay for that crime. But from God's point of view and for our care for people, there is no difference between this type of suffering or that type of suffering. This type of suffering, which you might say is deserved, is a proper consequence, and this type of suffering, which just happened because there is sin in the world. We must be compassionate and caring people and care for those who are suffering, care for those who are in difficult situations, and through the love of Christ, we help people through their consequences. We say, "Yeah, there are natural consequences to these acts of sleeping around or whatever you did," and we help people through that and try to restore relationships. And so David is talking about the fear of these consequences. The consequences are the Philistines want to kill him. They want to put him on trial, if the Philistines even did that, for killing Goliath and for killing 10,000 Philistines. And so he has this fear, and he's talking about how they are coming against him and how they are the ones who are wrong, but they are still coming against him. And his conclusion is, though I fear, though I am in great fear and afraid, I will trust in God because people cannot do anything to me. And on one hand, that is a great theological truth. On the other hand, people can do a lot to us. People can hurt us. They can say nasty things. They can throw rocks at us. They can accuse us of crimes that we didn't commit. There's all sorts of things on this world that are motivated by people that can do stuff to us. But ultimately, and David is always looking to the ultimate, he is always looking to what comes next or the future, he is saying, whatever this world throws at me, whatever the people of this world throw at me, whatever I put myself in the middle of that I shouldn't have, whatever is happening to me, though I am afraid, I will trust God because ultimately there is nothing anybody in this world can do to me. Though I be locked up, though I be beat up, though I be taken for everything that I have, there are no eternal consequences for the stuff that is happening to me. And that is a difficult eternal truth for people to take today, because people want to be treated kindly and people want to be not offended and people want to be with kind and nice people, and that whatever is going on, people want to be taken care of no matter where their mind is, no matter where their belief is, no matter where their faith is, no matter what view they have of God, they want to be treated with dignity. And that is the message that is coming out of the world today, is that we need to accept people as they are, whether they are in sin or whether they are in Christ, whether they are living for themselves or whether they are living for Christ. And David is saying that this only works if, one, you believe in God. I have to believe in God. I have to believe that God is sovereign, that He is there, that He created all this and that He cares about it. That He cares about it so much, we would say, David didn't know this, but we would say that God Almighty sent His Son to die for us. One theologian that I have listened to before says John 3:16 this way, "For God so loved the world that He sent Christ to get it back." God loves the world. God lost the world, in quotes and italics, and He didn't really lose anything, but He lost the world with Adam's sin in the garden. And they were kicked out, and the situation of walking with God in the cool of the evening was lost and has been lost and will not be gained until Jesus Christ comes back again. All that God had set up for the benefit of people, for the benefit of mankind, was lost when we decided to sin. And God's love and care for us has been traced and can be traced throughout the whole Old Testament. Things seem to be falling apart and the world seems to be turning against God. And God says, "Oh yeah?" And He picks Abram. And that starts things in motion with Abram and with Isaac and with Jacob and with the 12 sons and the captivity in Egypt and Moses. This starts things in process where He is building a people that will be the the homestead where Christ will come through, that God will send Christ through the Jewish people because he loves us so much that no matter what we're going through, no matter what challenges, difficulties, tragedies, unbelievable consequences to the things that are just unfair, that the whole world is against us, all of that is taken care of. And I can look at Christ and I can say, though I am afraid, though I hate what I'm going through, though I don't understand, I can't make heads or tails out of it, 2 and 2 do not equal 4, this is the most unfair, difficult thing I've ever seen. Though all that is happening, I will trust in God through Jesus Christ, because ultimately, nobody on this earth can do anything to my soul. Nobody on this earth can do anything with my relationship with Jesus Christ. Once I am in his hands, in Christ's hands, there's no army, there's no salesman, there's no politician, there's nobody who can convince Christ to let me go. I am stuck, I am in there, no matter what happens to us. And so the story of David of saying, they stir up strife, they look, they watch my steps, as they waited for their life. For their crime will they escape in wrath, cast down the peoples, O God. That we can see this, that things are against us sometimes, that things don't go right sometimes, that life can be frustrating and annoying, and we need to stop and say, whatever this is, it's fear, or it's pain, or it's a challenge, or it's a difficulty, whatever this is, I will trust in God, because whatever this is can never affect my relationship with God. And then David continues in 8, and he kind of does this very poetic way of saying that God knows what's going on. He says, you have kept count of my tossings, put my tears in your bottle. Are they not written in your book? In other words, David knows that whatever is going on in my life, whatever thing that I think is out of control or difficult, God knows all about it. There is a memorial, if you will, that is talked about in ancient literature and even early American literature, of saving the tears in a bottle, that when you go through a really difficult time, you save your tears in a bottle or on a handkerchief or something like that, and that becomes a memorial of the difficult times that you have gone through, that when you are on this side of it, when you are on the pleasurable side of life as it comes every once in a while, that these things you can look back and you can say, God knew. I had a memorial set up to my suffering. And David is saying, God knew. God is the one keeping the memorial. He's actually writing down all of my struggles in a book. He's writing down all of my difficulties. He is not absent. He is not uneducated. He's not ignorant of what's going on. And some would say, well, then do something about it. God needs to do something about my suffering. But that isn't the point of life. Sad to report, the point of life is not for God to take care of all of the problems that you have. You live in a sinful, broken world. You are sinful and broken. Even if you're saved, you're sinful and broken. Paul talks about the struggle between the flesh and the spirit, that this is a broken system. And it will not be fixed until Jesus Christ comes again. And then you will be unbroken. You will be glorified and you will be perfected. And you will walk the new heaven and the new earth. And you will walk with Jesus. And all will be great and all will be understood at that point. But right now, we need to look at our situation and say, I may be afraid, I may not understand, but I will trust in God because there's nothing on this world that can hurt me. He then in 12 ends by saying, I must perform my vows to you, O God. I will render thanksgiving, thank offerings to you. He is talking about the vows that he made when he was bar mitzvahed, when he understood the law, the vows of Deuteronomy for David. We have made certain vows, as it were, to Christ. When I accept Christ, I make the promise that I will follow. We have said, I've decided to follow Jesus. We sing this song. That is one of the promises or vows, if you will, that we make when we become a Christian. We make certain indications that I'm going to have a relationship with God, and that will, of course, grow as we become a Christian. We stay in His Word. We stay in church. We pray, and we have this mindset that whatever is going on in the world, though I be afraid, though I don't like it, I trust in God because God cares enough to send His Son to save me. Says, ends with, for you have delivered my soul from death, yes, my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of life. The light of life we know now is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ declared himself in the book of John, the light of the world. We do walk in the light of Jesus Christ, that his situation, and that is one interesting thing about the Psalms and this one, is that he wrote it long after he was saved from the Philistines. He probably wrote it after he was king, remembering back. But it is remembering a time when he was harassed by the Philistines because he walked into their hometown. And in his mindset, even though his situation hasn't changed, his mindset about his situation has changed. Though I have a difficulty and the consequences may still be coming on, I may have done something so dumb and stupid and ill-informed that the consequences may take years to take care of, that I may have to spend years of my life and finances or whatever to take care of the consequences. But during that time, I can still be closer to God, know that God has saved me from death, know that the taking care of the consequences through earthly, worldly means, as it were, is God keeping me from failing, that I am not destroyed, I do not fail, even though I go through difficult times. There are people who have written about, they've kind of studied life on this planet for the last several thousand years of recorded history. And the conclusion they come to, if you look at how life on this planet is difficulty, 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 difficulty with a little bit of pleasure and fun. Difficulty, 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 difficulty with a little bit of pleasure and fun. Life is hard. Life is difficult. But there is pleasure and there is fun. And we can either get mad at it and say, I don't want life to be that way. And a lot of people are doing that today. And their answer is, sue them. Sue people who make life difficult. That only makes life more difficult for everybody. Life is difficult. Life is hard. We have a tendency to look at our life in America as more peaceful and pleasurable. But in the large scope of things, God, because he kind of lets our sin go, do whatever we want, we make a pretty horrific planet to live on. A lot of people are killing each other, putting people in jail for their beliefs or their political acumen. We need to rise above it, and even in a most difficult situation, and we see that in the things that are coming out of China, for example, as Christians and more Muslims than Christians, but Christians and Muslims are put in re-education camps, where they teach people to deny God and to become good communists, even though these things are happening, the letters that are being snuck out of China are showing such a great explosion of the Christian faith as people are being arrested and put in gulags because they're Christians. More people are being saved. Why? Because they see their faith, they see their trust in God, they see that even though they're afraid and even though the worst thing you can imagine is being in a Chinese gulag, the worst thing, if you are in there as a Christian, you are free, you are saved from death, your foot is kept from falling, and though you hate it, you can still trust in God because there's nothing they can do to you, no matter whether you're free or in prison. Paul understood this as he wrote the end of Romans 8, and he put it this way: "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the only, is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword, as it is written from the Psalms, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are super conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, we just praise your name that whatever the world throws at us, nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. No matter what stupid things we do, nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. No matter what is going on in Washington or in China or in Russia or any place else in the world, no matter what is going on, even though it seems like all are against us, we know that you are bigger and nothing can separate us from the love of God. Lord, we praise you for that and pray that you would drill this into our hearts and our minds. We ask all this through the blood of Christ. Amen.